this is Angela Anderson. Thanks for joining me today. We are going to be doing a really fun project. Hope you're ready to paint with me. I've got my husband Mark here with me.
Hey there, everybody.
And we're going to be doing hot air balloons. Really simple landscape. I think this is a good, the landscape portion would be for beginners. The hot air balloons were a little bit more tricky, but I'm going to show you kind of a more simplified way to do it and then a more complicated way if you want to put in more detail. So I think it'll be a pretty fairly easy project on the whole, maybe a couple hours. I'm not sure yet. So I did the example pretty loose and it didn't take me very long. So we'll try to keep it easy. And today we are going to be announcing our giveaway that if you watched my Rose video last Saturday, I have some Winsor & Newton products to give away, and we already did the entry, so don't try to enter. It's over. We've got some winners, and I wanted to announce who won. So the third place winner with the three Cottman brushes is, let me pull up the screenshot here. This is really high tech. We're going to do it from my phone. You're going to have to see the phone. Lori Riley. She's from Sweet Home, Alabama, USA. So congratulations, Lori. You are the third place winner. Is this? Your screen looks really dark. Okay, there's the next one. Okay, so second place is the winner of these four brushes. They're the Winsor & Newton Artist Acrylic Set. And the winner was Heather Pearson. She's from Toronto, Canada. Pearson, sorry, I keep saying Pearson. Pearson. Heather, congratulations. And our grand prize winner, don't peek. Almost gave it away. I'm gonna get it zoomed in here. And she is winning the big bamboo box set from Winsor & Newton with all kinds of goodies in it. And the winner is Emily Kay. Whoops, my lights are showing there. Emily is from the U.S., so she won, and congratulations. And I recognized Emily, so I'm glad she's one of our regulars that won. That's awesome. So thank you all for joining and entering in that contest. It was really fun, and we had a ton, over several hundred entries.
700, 800 entries,
yeah,
something like that.
It was a lot, so yeah. It was great. That tube buddy picker worked great,
helped out,
too.
Yeah.
It actually worked out that the U.S. folks won the grand prize, and I didn't have to pick a...
Yeah, and Stickman wants a recount, though.
Stickman wants a
recount? Yeah.
Stickman was hoping to win.
Yeah, he thought that he should have won. There was some bias there or something.
I didn't see him enter.
You didn't see his name?
No.
Yeah. Interesting.
That was your job.
Well, he wanted the Sharpies. He wanted Sharpies anyways.
He's one of our employees.
Oh,
so
okay. All right. He can't win. And the Sharpies weren't part of the award. So.
No, he wouldn't have cared for brushes. All right. So I used a pretty limited palette for this. I went off the photograph that you see in the corner there, and I brightened up the colors just a tad. They're a little bit more muted, but I wanted to kind of brighten them up a little bit. So we've got zinc white for some of the clouds and fog down in here. If you don't have zinc white, you could use a glazing medium with your regular white. So regular titanium white, unbleached titanium, which is a off-white color mixed by mixing the white and a little bit of yellow oxide, which is this color. Yeah, cadmium yellow medium, quinacridone magenta. You could use any kind of crimson, purpley red, burnt sienna, phthalo blue green shade, and carbon black. So,
and Emily Kay is in chat, and she says, thank you
Emily.
So much. Yeah.
I'll get in contact with you, Emily. You can send me your address, and I'll get those out this week to everybody that won. So I'll be contacting you. Look for it. All right. So I'm going to do the background first. I think I'm just going to start with the sky. We'll let that dry, and we'll work on this, and then we'll put our clouds in last, or our, not clouds, hot air balloons. I'm going to set that aside here. And I really, the photograph, if you look at it, the sky and the foreground are almost split in half, which is not something that I would normally recommend, but it actually works with this because the focal point is up in the third quadrant right here. That big hot air balloon is going to be right up here. So it draws your eye to that. Normally, I wouldn't like cut the horizon line in the middle of a painting. It's usually better to do it on the upper third or lower third, but it works for this one, I think. So we're just going to go with it. That's what it was in our reference photo. I'm going to grab a little bit of water on my large flat brush here and just start out by grabbing some white and a little bit of cadmium yellow. A little bit of yellow oxide just to kind of cut the vibrancy just a little bit. We don't want it so super in your face yellow. And we're going to start up at the top. And I'll be doing like horizontal brush strokes, and that'll kind of emphasize the clouds. So any kind of streaks that you'll see will just look like they're clouds or something. And the clouds in this are pretty pretty basic. They're really not like your typical fluffy clouds. They're sort of those streaky clouds that happen sometimes. So I'm going to grab a little bit of pink, just a tiny bit, just to kind of tint that and start getting a little bit of pink streaks in it. The sun is going to be coming from this direction over here, so I'm going to keep this pretty bright on this side. Grab a little bit more white. And let's get a little bit more of this pink. Maybe cut it with a little bit of the burnt sienna just to dull it slightly. There we go. We'll start putting in some of these clouds. Sort of just, I'm kind of wisping through this wet paint. Let's grab some more of the white and yellow. Get some of the yellow going. Now you could use glazing medium for this to help extend your drying time. If you have golden acrylic glazing medium, that'll work to help. I'm trying to keep these very soft though. You can kind of see the color. The colors are very spring-like, I guess. You could use a filbert for this if you wanted to help give your clouds a little bit more roundedness, but I think this is working out okay. Grab a little bit more of the yellow oxide as I get down toward my horizon line. It's mixing with that quinacridone magenta to make more of an orangey color. And go down a little bit lower than halfway because you want your mountains to be able to go up and have, you don't want to have to paint back in some sky to fill in or anything. So go down lower than you think you need to for these. It's just below halfway. Grab a little bit more white and put more white on this side a little bit just to brighten it up slightly. You can tell I'm ready for spring. Paint all these spring colors.
Well, somebody asked in chat, what colors would you use if you wanted the painting to look like the picture?
I would just use darker versions of these. So I would just mute them with like more burnt sienna or something like that to darken them up. I'm going to do that right now. Actually, I'm going to put in some clouds with this darker and I'm going to grab a little bit of blue too. Just grab the unbleached titanium. I'm going to put a little bit of blue. Ooh, that's pretty bright. Didn't really mean for it to be that bright. Let me grab a little bit of white and go back over that a little bit. There we go. Blend that in. I'm using the same colors. I'm just lightening them. So it's pretty much the same colors, just maybe less white in yours if you wanted to use the same, do the same thing in your painting. So if that helps. They're basically the same undertones. I'm just adding more white to mine to soften them. Okay, so there's kind of a dark cloud right through here that kind of goes through. So I think I'm going to grab some yellow oxide and some burnt sienna for that one. And I've still got these blues and things in my brush, so it'll kind of make it a gray color. It's not, whoops, I got black there, darn it. Didn't mean to do that. Okay, I'm going to have to clean that up. Stay away from the black. Ruin my pretty little puddle. Here, I'm going to grab some of that blue color so I have a little bit in my brush over here. And grab my yellow and my burnt sienna. Maybe a tiny bit of red. And a teeny tiny bit of the blue.
There's some red-headed Sherpa lady.
Hey, chat. Cinnamon. Cinnamon and I came up. This is a collaboration. Oh, I forgot to mention that. Hello. This is a collaboration project with my friend Cinnamon Cooney, the Art Sherpa. She is going to be coming on later on tonight at 6 p.m. Central with her hot air balloon, and I got to see a preview of it, and it was really, really cool. So hope you check that out, and the iCard for that is up. If you see the little eye with the circle up in the top corner, there's a link to her video in there.
Should I go to it now?
No,
oh,
not yet.
Oh, okay.
Six.
Oh, okay. I'm sorry. I saw the eye.
Okay, good. All right, so I'm putting in some just little gray clouds here. If you wanted to, you could switch to like a fuzzy brush like that. You know, my little Deerfoot that I like to use. But since these are kind of horizontal shaped clouds, I think that it works to use the bigger brush. It's not bother me. So I'm going to go ahead and keep that. And I'm just sort of doing these random shapes. I'm not, your brain is going to tell you that a cloud needs to look like you're going to paint. And your brain is going to say, no, a cloud needs to look like this. It's got to have these solid, fluffy, round things. That's a cloud, right? And it's going to make you want to put it in solid, like you did when you were in sixth grade, or, you know, whatever, because that's when when you were 6 years old, or whenever it was that you were forming your words, you formed pictures for whatever those words were in your brain. So, like, cloud is formed in your brain as a certain picture. And usually it's this kind of weird, rounded shape. I'm not doing a very good job of it, but you get the idea. And so your brain's going to fight you every time you try to paint a cloud in any kind of different way besides what your brain thinks it's supposed to look like. It'll fight you. So just don't listen to it. You just got to go. You just got to go with, do what you're seeing, not what your brain is telling you, you know, because it will be, that's one of the biggest hurdles that new artists have, is to overcome their left brain, right brain, you know, thing. Your right brain's telling you what it sees, and it's, you know, working out the shapes, and your left brain's going, no, that's not what a cloud looks like, because I figured that out when I was 6 years old, and it looks like this other thing, so.
You're not suggesting that artists don't have a brain?
I'm not. I'm saying they use their right side of the brain, which is not where their language side is stored, and the language side and the right side don't always gel. Because we've got these preconceived notions, and especially things like this, you know, things that are a little bit, I don't know, it's sometimes the most basic things like trees and clouds and things that you might have already drawn when you were a child, that usually give people the hardest time with painting and drawing, because they already have these preconceived notions of how it's supposed to look, and when they do it differently, their brains freak out. And everybody's does that. It's just normal. So just don't listen to it. Don't go super poofy. Just keep them Just keep them horizontal. I promise you it'll look good. It's not going to look good to you when you're doing it. You're going to really think that this looks terrible. But then when you kind of step back and look at it later, you're like, oh, okay, I see it now. So just kind of try to do what I'm doing here and trust that it'll come out. Hope that made sense, but okay, I'm put a little bit of purple. I mixed up a little bit of blue with this quinacridone, and I'm putting a little bit of purple in some of these. All right, I think that's about all we're gonna need to do. We'll come back in and I'll add some white streaks to this, but I'm gonna let it dry so that I can get the white on top of what I've got going on here, and I might add a little bit more blue over here. We'll see what color it dries. So let's put in our clouds, and our mountains. They're going to be purple. So I'm just going to add a little bit of blue and quinacridone together again. And I'm going to mix it with my unbleached titanium. That'll kind of mute the colors a little bit since it's got that yellow in it. And if you want it to be a little bit more purple, just add a little bit more of the quinacridone. And if you want it to be more on the blue side, you can add more blue. But I'm kind of wanting to go for a purple that's very, very muted. Okay, so I've got my middle value purple here. And I'm going to add some more white to it, this unbleached titanium, and make a second lighter value out of it. So this will be our farthest, and this will be a little bit closer. And so the farthest one is going to be kind of these, and I'm not even really looking at the picture very much, but the photograph kind of does this bowl shape a little bit, slightly. If you look at the horizon line, there's just a slight rise on this side and then up again on this side. And there's this far mountains right in the middle. And then these side mountains sort of come in front of them a little bit. Okay, so that's all you need to do for that one. And then we'll grab the darker value one and do the larger mountain coming over here. And we can even actually, now that I think about it, I'm going to grab some of this mixing white or zinc white, and I'm going to put a little bit of that up here and just pull it up from the bottom up towards our mountains while it's wet. It'll kind of, it's a transparent, so it'll be subtle, but you'll see it when you put these darker color in there. So I'm going to make sure I have a little bit of white. Actually, I might just use the straight white too. It's not showing up very good. There we go. A little bit of white down there. You don't have to worry about overblending it or anything. It doesn't have to be perfectly blended for you to get that effect. And I'm leaving it fairly choppy. This is probably a little bit more of a, I would say, impressionist style type painting, the way I've done it in the example and what I'm doing today. So trying not to get too fussy with the being perfect about all of it. We're just trying to get our shapes right and get the values right. And so when I say values, that just means light and dark. So we're trying to, usually with landscapes, or you know, general rule is that your farthest mountains are going to be darkest or lightest, and they'll get darker as you come closer to you. The farther away they are, they're also going to be more gray or blue or less saturated with color. So that's why I'm cutting it with the duller of the two whites. I'm not putting the bright white with it, because that'll help dull the color a little bit. I'm trying to get a similar blend here. I didn't mix enough of it.
Somebody asked, is there any way to mix paints to get an unbleached titanium look?
Yeah, it's pretty much titanium white and yellow oxide comes pretty close. You can also add maybe a little touch of burnt sienna or burnt umber, or not burnt sienna, burnt umber or burnt raw umber. So, okay.
Take
it titanium white, titanium white, a little bit of yellow oxide, or raw sienna. Those two colors are kind of a yellowy brown, right? And then a little bit of raw umber or burnt umber to brown it out a little bit. So it'll be yellows when you add the yellows, and then you can add a little teeny tiny bit of brown to dull it even more if you wanted to. So hope that helped. I don't know if that makes sense, but.
Okay, I was going to say nobody expects a Spanish Inquisition.
That's right.
All right, let me go out and come back.
Let me go out and come back again. Our three main things, colors are white and we entertain ourselves. If you haven't seen that Monty Python skit, you might want to treat yourself to that.
You'd have to see that.
It's pretty funny.
For sure.
It's a classic. Okay, so I darkened it up a little bit so you could kind of see the difference there between the two. I don't want to go too dark with this, though, because we're going to get darker as we come forward. So I might go back in now with my white. And there's a little bit of mist in this one, so I'm going to blend it in while it's wet just a little bit. And then doesn't have to be perfect. I don't have a lot of paint in my brush, so it's not, and really, if you want to use glazing medium, that might help it blend a little bit, give you a little bit more working time. So I'm working pretty quickly here, so it's not drying on me too much. But if you're, you know, if you're a little bit slower and it's taking you a while to get all the way across here, and then you go back with your white, it may have been dry already and it might lift on you if you mess with it too much. So just, if that's the case, I would let it dry completely and come back in with the white with a little bit of glazing medium, or even mix a color that's got a little bit of this purple in it with the white, just to kind of have a lighter value with the glazing medium. To hope that's making sense. All right, so that's good. Just a little bit of lighter color right along that horizon line there. Need more white. How are we doing in chat today?
Oh, everybody's doing well.
Got a good group, all the regulars.
Well, yeah. Relative, yeah, they're all right people.
I saw people in there chatting early.
Oh, yeah. People were in a couple hours early there.
That's sweet. Mm-hmm. Well, they were missing Cinnamon, so she usually comes on at 11, so were all
going through withdrawals.
Exactly. She's got something with her kiddos today.
They had a soapbox derby.
Yeah. Oh, I remember when Nathan did that. You remember that?
Barely.
When they were in the scouts. Okay, I'm just pulling
that
up.
That was Jordan, wasn't it?
Oh, maybe it was Jordan. Yeah, I just remember that they did the soapbox derby. We didn't get the memo that they were supposed to. He was just visiting with a friend on the day that they did the derby. And so somebody let him borrow their spare car, and he won. He came home with the trophy. I'm like, I bet they were kicking themselves for letting Jordan have the spare. Okay, I'm adding a little bit of glazing medium here because it just to show you how that looks. Okay, I'm not going to mess with it too much. I don't want to spend too much time on that. So right in here, there's kind of some pinkish. It kind of turns a little bit of pink. So I'm going to spray my palette down. It's starting to get dry. And I'm just going to make a color that's got a little bit of pink in it. It's just a little bit dulled. And I'm going to sort of come along this bottom of this mountain and add a little bit of foreground in here. Keep it horizontal. I hope this is it zoomed in enough for people to see what I'm doing? I know it's kind of hard because it's such a long canvas.
Yeah.
It'd be hard to zoom in on this. I'm going from side to side.
Plus, I'd have to pay attention
just a
more.
A little bit of purpley. Yeah. You would have to earn your keep today. Okay, so that's good. We just want to come down a little bit because we're going to put some trees in here, our first layer of background trees. These are very, very narrow, these first ones. So I'm going to use my colors that I'm going to use for the trees are phthalo blue and burnt sienna. It might seem like a weird combination, but it makes this really beautiful green, teal green color. Deep. It's very dark. So add a little bit extra because we're going to use it a lot. So there's that, and then I'm going to use that burnt, that light blue, the or not light, I can't use my words today. The words are not, I'm too.
Well, people are saying that Zoom would be okay, but.
Okay, let me zoom in for the trees part.
Yeah.
A little bit.
I'll try to watch.
Okay. This will be better right there. Now that I'm not up here in the sky, it'll be closer. Okay. It's got a little shine on it right here too. Shadow it. Okay, so there's a ridge of trees that comes up. And I'm looking at the horizontal here, right? I may actually, now that I'm looking at it, I need to add a little bit more white down here. I'm going to use this pink color. Add a little bit more white and just put in some of that down here. So with your layers, come down a little bit farther than you think you need to with them, because that way you'll have something behind your trees if you. Okay, there we go. Oop, missed the bowl. All right, so I mixed up the dark blue and burnt sienna. It's probably more on the blue side. And then I added some of this unbleached titanium to it to lighten it up. And now I'm going to do a horizontal line of trees, and they're going to start right in here. And I actually like that this is kind of wet underneath it because it'll help it blend out a little bit. If you're doing this in you see that? If you're doing this and making it darker, I would just keep maybe a little bit more of the darker colors in your brush. Just tapping the tip. I'm not laying it flat because, of course, it's so big it would cover too much. And actually, a fan brush would probably work just as well or better for this little bit, this farther back part here. I'm going to add a little bit more of the darker to it. There we go. And when I'm putting in these trees, I'm just kind of varying the size, keeping these back ones very small and densely packed. There is a little bit of dark here and there, so I'm just adding a little hint of dark to them. And come down a little bit farther with them into this white part, just on these middle ones, because this part is going to have some more fog coming up than this part over here. Excuse me. Okay, so I get over here. There's a few more, but I'm just going to keep looking at my line and make sure I'm keeping these sort of horizontal here so they're not tilting off the in a weird direction. Okay. Leaving a little bit of space, and mostly at the top, you want there to be some air there for them to look like bushes. Go back in with this dark, add a few little dark taps. Then just at the bottom, I'm going to kind of scrub it horizontally a little bit to smear it. Okay. I'm going to grab an angle brush. I'm going to switch to a smaller brush so I can get a little bit more control. I'm going to grab my purple color. More quinacridone, or more of the unbleached titanium here. And maybe just a little bit of the zinc white. And we're going to go over the bottoms of these trees just a little bit with this color. It'll set it back. It's not pure white. If you look at the picture, it's not pure white. It's got all these other colors that you're seeing through it, so you don't want it to go in with straight white or it would look unnatural. It's going to have all the colors of the sky and other things in this mist. Okay, so coming up, blending over. It'll make it look like you've got kind of some, maybe some things going in here. If you skip around a little bit, don't do a solid color. Some areas go a little bit brighter than others. Leave a little bit of space here and there. It'll make it look like things are popping up through the clouds or the mist. Okay.
So we got a question in chat saying the person is a beginner.
Yes.
And they're wondering what you would recommend them to start or practice painting on. Would it be a canvas or would it be some sort of a practice pad or something like that?
You know, it depends. The paper I find is great for me. But it does feel differently than a canvas does. It absorbs more water. And so it's kind of, you have to approach it just a little bit differently than you do a canvas. If a lot of times what I did with my kids' classes, I use these canvas panels. Oh, I didn't mention that this is a 12 by 16. Oh, well, too late now.
Okay, let's start over again.
Yeah, I know.
No? Okay.
Go back to the beginning.
And it's in the description down below.
Yeah, it's in the description, yeah. I just didn't mention it. I usually mention what size I'm using. So the canvas panels I find are a little bit easier to start with because they don't flex as much when you're using a stretch canvas. The middle part will flex on you because it's not got anything solid underneath of it, and use my grammar. And so it can kind of be hard, especially if you're doing any fine lines or anything like that, because you're every time you put your hand on it or something, it'll move on you. So I find that these canvas panels, and they're cheaper to use too, you know. So like a canvas panel this size is probably $2, and then, you know, if you were to go up to a canvas, it'd be probably closer to $5. So you'll save yourself quite a bit if you're doing a lot of practicing by just using these practice canvas panels. And then you can always go to a bigger, you know, more expensive canvas if you like your practice one.
Okay. And then somebody asked, do you or have you ever reused a canvas before? And if you did, how do you prep it to paint over again?
You can just use gesso on, as long, even if it's been varnished, you can still gesso over a canvas. I wouldn't use, you know, make sure that you're not trying to go over an oil painting because that's not going to gel. But if it's an acrylic canvas, all you need to do, I mean, you could even paint over it with just your regular acrylics, even if it's not varnished, but or even if it is varnished, you still can. I'm adding a little bit of this mist color up back in here just to soften this up. Yeah, that's totally doable. Just prep it with gesso, give it a couple coats, do it in opposite directions. So paint the gesso on this way, let it dry, then paint it on this way and let it dry. And that'll kind of help cover any brush strokes or anything that are underneath it.
Okay, and then somebody says that they're using a Artist Loft and Liquitex Basic, but they find the paints are kind of thin.
Yeah.
So what would you recommend? Should they move up to the heavy body paints? I mean,
if they're ready for, yeah, if they want to invest in it, if they're, you know, if you're seriously painting a lot and, you know, you're ready for better quality paints, yeah, I'm really finding that Golden are my favorite right now. Liquitex has been a little bit more on the inconsistent side, and they seem to dry out faster on me in the bottles for some reason, and I don't know if that's just me, but grab some of this green and just do a tiny bit of green right here. Okay. All right. So we're good. Let's do our next layer of trees. And I'm going to grab this brush again, and we'll grab our color here. And right in the middle, there's a big tree right here. Comes down, or some sort of bush or something. A little bit darker right here. There. There's some trees right here. I'm going to have to put some of this lighter color right here before I go all the way across with this. But this has lighter colors right here. I'm just using the tip and sort of scrubbing it in circles. It's sort of will okay.
Another question asking, what colors could you mix to get something like a phthalo blue?
What colors do they have? That would be my first question. Phthalo blue is a more of a blue green.
Okay, let me go low. Hold on a sec. I'll be right back.
Did they say already?
No.
Oh.
No, I was just going to run over to their place real quick. Ask them to hold it up so we can see. Nope.
Okay, I'm going to go over this with my. It's actually still wet, so it's picking up a little bit of the color, which I kind of like. I just need a little bit of this fog going over this tree here before I continue this. These trees go all the way across, so grab a little bit more of the brighter white because this is starting to get a little bit more bright, and I think I'm going to do a little bit of yellow in it. Maybe the yellow, cadmium yellow, picking up from the sunlight, hitting it over here. There we go. Put some of that yellow down here. Hope I'm not going too fast over this. It's just kind of layers of color. Basically, as long as you remember that the colors are getting darker as they get closer to the bottom of the canvas, you could use whatever colors you wanted in here, really, with your white to make this fog. You just get your dark and light values correct. Make sure you've got enough contrast between the trees and your fog. You can see I'm not going all the way up over the top of in the darkest parts, but I am kind of keeping that fog sort of down toward the bottom area there. These ones actually aren't quite as foggy, so there's more of the actual bushes showing, so I'm not going to cover them up as much. But that bottom needs to be a straight line, so I'm going to grab a little bit of that blue green from them, and I'm going to go through here and just firm up the bottoms of these with a little bit of that color through that mist. So these are all sort of straight along the bottom. Okay, it's starting to lift right here. You can see where it's picking up the color that was underneath, and you're seeing the white canvas underneath. So I need to stop messing with it and let it dry, or it will lift off completely. The acrylics, when they get dry, they start to dry, they get sticky, and they'll stick to your brush or anything else that touches them. Okay, so let's see. We're right here. We've got this tree in here. So this line continues all the way down here. I want to pull down this mist area. Actually, there's a little bit of trees that I need to put in there right here, and they're very faint.
Somebody asked, how do you keep the paint from going all the way up to the ferrule when you're painting?
Well, mainly you're controlling the amount of paint, and if I get too much paint on it, there's two things. I'm pulling from the side of the puddle, so I'm not dipping my whole brush into the middle of this big thing. When I need a little bit of color, I just pull it from the side like this. And I've only got a little tiny bit that I'm working with at a time. And then if I get too much on it and I scoop up, you know, way too much and it's globbing and it's going to get in my ferrule, I just set it down and sort of smoosh it off of my brush and sort of almost like a shovel or squeegee. I just kind of press down real hard and then smoosh off the extra paint so that it doesn't get up where I don't want it to be. That's just a matter of experience. You know, the more you paint, the more you'll kind of get used to controlling the amount of paints that you've got on your brush. Just okay, so I'm going to grab some little bit of this white. I'm just going to pick up some of the white that's on here, and I'm going to do this layer that's sort of in the fog. You're not seeing a whole lot of it. It's just kind of a color in here. There. And then we'll do another layer of the, grab the unbleached titanium this time, pull it through some of that purple, and we'll just go over the bottom of that. In this case, it doesn't really have to be that zinc white because it's already kind of light colors, so. Let's see, I think that's looking good. So I just wanted to make sure that this was going to have something for my trees, because I want to keep this line of trees horizontal here. So I'm going to make sure that I have color underneath them before I put them in, if that makes sense. So grab a little bit of the darker, and they're a little bit darker on this side than they were on this side here. So I'm going to skip over. I don't want to lose all this nice fog right there, so I'm going to keep these bushes pretty low right here. You could use a smaller deer foot if you have one. I'd probably go to a quarter inch. Probably be a little bit easier to control in these little tight spaces, but this is a 3/8 inch, so okay, a little bit taller right there. And as I get closer to the bottom, my trees and bushes are going to get a little bit bigger. So they're getting closer to me. I can see more of them. They're just getting larger generally as you get closer to them, obviously. So stop laughing. Just softening up those outer edges. I don't want them to be too... Whoops, I'm covering up my canvas there. Sorry, let me put that down. And one of the things, if you don't have this kind of a deerfoot stippler brush, you could use any kind of scruffy brushes they've got. They've got different ones. You know, anything that says stippler or foliage or... you know, scruffy brush. I don't know if that's a real name of a brush, but you get the idea. Like if you have an old brush or even like a one like this that's a hog hair bristle, these are, you know, stiffer bristles. Don't wet it, and don't wet these either because it gets a little bit soggy. So I forgot to mention that. But if you use the natural hair bristle brushes, they usually tend to do well for these kind of scruffy trees and clouds and things. Okay, so there we go. We went all the way across with that one. And then we'll add a little bit of our fog underneath it. So I've got some glazing medium this time. Let me show you with the glazing medium. We'll use glazing medium, a little bit of white with that color that we were using. We'll put the glazing medium on. Get a little bit more white. The glazing medium pretty much does the same thing as the zinc white does. It just makes it a little bit more transparent. Although titanium white is opaque. So zinc white is probably your best bet to get a more transparent look. But it does work if you use glazing medium. All right, I'm just fuzzing out the bottom edges there of this. Some horizontal lines here. Let's see. Let's go ahead and add a little bit of the yellow oxide to it as we get down toward the bottom too. Grab my zinc white. We'll add a little bit of that color to our fog. It might be showing the green. We'll have more green below in this area as we get closer to the bottom, so we'll add a little bit of yellow to our fog there. To
it has been confirmed that there is such a thing as a scruffy brush.
Well, there you go. I thought I wasn't making that up. Just thinking about colors here, sorry. Okay, just going all the way down.
Are you okay?
Yep, I am. My palette's not. I'm just using this gray color with a little bit of yellow. It's that, and I'm grabbing the zinc white to help it blend. And let's grab a little bit of glazing medium to make it flow a little bit better. There we go. And again, I'm not going all the way up. If you get a little too high, you can use your finger to kind of rub off a little bit of it. I'm trying to keep the bottom sort of in a straight-ish line. It doesn't have to be perfectly straight, and it probably is better if it's not, because it'll look a little bit more natural. But you get the idea, what we got going on there. And now we're going to put in our big hill that's right here. So that's going to go in with, I'll just grab this brush, use this brush again, and use the phthalo blue and yellow oxide. That'll make a kind of a toned down green. We'll grab a little bit of the unbleached titanium to soften it slightly. We'll use that to put in. It's kind of a still a turquoise color. I might get a little bit of yellow, cadmium yellow, to get like a brighter version and use them both. So it's kind of slopes down, curved at the top a little bit. I need to bring this color down here in the middle a little bit farther down, but I can just do that later. Or actually, I need to bring it up on this side now that I'm looking at it. Bring it up a little higher over here. There we go. And I'm pulling my brush strokes sort of horizontal and sloping it down just a little bit so that they're kind of indicating maybe this is a hill that's kind of rolling in this direction. Grab a little bit of yellow and throw in a little bit of this yellow while it's wet in a couple places. Grab a little bit more of that turquoise. Yeah, I'm gonna have to bring this white down that was up there, but looks like probably go kind of straight across with that. Just bring it up a little higher. There, I want to keep it in that blue though, that blue family. So I'm going to mix up a little bit more of my phthalo blue with burnt sienna and throw a little bit of that in there so that it doesn't look like I've completely changed color. There we go. Then over here, I'm going to use my white with this color. I'm just going to soften up. This area is kind of in fog, so I'm going to grab a little bit more of my white and just blend over that edge there and just do these kind of little horizontal lines. It doesn't have to be anything very perfect or definite. Just very lightly brushing horizontal there to kind of fuzz out that area there. Fuzz out, that's a technical, very artsy term. That'll be in my book when it comes out.
Is that just going to be just a mention or a whole chapter?
Fuzzing out.
Yeah.
How to.
How to fuzz out.
I'm not coming out with a book, by the way, so just to, maybe eventually, but not, so don't ask where you can get it. It's not there yet. Thought I might mention that because I'll get comments. Okay, so I'm going to use a little bit of this color in here too.
You know I wouldn't read it, right? Because I don't really read books.
That's true. I'd have to have a lot of pictures.
A lot of pictures. Some stuff about video games in there, too.
I don't know about that. Okay. I don't know a lot about video games. That's probably the wrong one for me. Okay, so even though, if you look at the picture, it's kind of hard to tell in that picture. It's pretty far away. But the trees, these two tree lines are not very far away, but I'm leaving this gap because once I put these trees in here, if I put my horizon line or this up too high, when I put my trees in it, it would cover these. So that's why I'm leaving a little bit of space right here for the trees to go. So if you're wondering about that, I know you're worried.
I was just over here thinking about that.
You were like, what? She doesn't, those are too low.
Yeah, exactly.
Okay, I'm adding a little bit of the yellow oxide color. And again, it doesn't have to be perfect. I'm just kind of trying to get an indication of those colors. Okay, so now for these trees, I'm going to go with in between these two colors to kind of pull them together to unify them. And I might even go back up in here with a little bit of this green and just touch in a little tiny bit of this foreground green in this layer here so that it is a little bit more unified. What are we doing on time? 1 hour. Okay, not too bad.
Somebody asked if yellow oxide and yellow ochre are the same.
Pretty much, yes. They're pretty much. Yellow ochre is the older, more, I think it's the, I'm not sure if it's a mineral, or, I don't know. It's the yellow oxide is a newer version that's a chemical composition. The yellow ochre, did I say oxide or ochre? Yellow oxide is the newer one. Yellow ochre is the older version. That's what I understand. I looked it up, so I'm not making this up. Because they looked the same to me, pretty much. Let me see if I can reach it. So there's yellow ochre and there's yellow oxide. The yellow oxide is just slightly more yellow, I would say. But they're almost identical. And it was just a modern way of making it without the whatever chemicals or whatever minerals that they were using for the ochre colors. Because, of course, you know, those older colors, they all were mixed from kinds of dangerous chemicals and things. That's why a lot of artists went mad. No joke.
Sure, blame it on the paint.
It's true.
Right.
Mm-hmm. It's very true. All right, I'm going to go ahead and switch to my smaller Deerfoot.
Somebody asked.
I wet my brush by accident. So.
Is there a reason why you decided not to start with any color in the background? You know, like with your canvas?
You know, this time I just, I could have, if I did a color, I would have done yellow oxide. So And it would have been a good base color. Honestly, I just didn't get this painted in time to really think about it. I was doing the example before we started, so like 2 hours ago. So I worked it out on the fly. I don't know why I grabbed that color. I'm going to grab burnt. Well, yeah, I did. I wanted a green with these three colors, yellow oxide, burnt, or yellow oxide, burnt sienna, and phthalo blue. So I'm doing that green. I'm going to go a little bit more blue on this tree and keep it pretty dark. This will be our darkest tree line here. Okay, so I don't know if I wasn't on camera there, sorry. All right, so we're going to do it. We're going to start kind of right here. We're not going all the way to the end. And I'm going to stay above the horizon line just slightly, leave a little bit of gap, because then I'm going to put in some little trunks. Thank you. Jeez. When I get to painting like this, it's so hard to talk sometimes. It's hard. It's not hard to talk. It's hard to label things. It's because that's on the left side. It's not, you know. I can talk stream of consciousness all day long, but I can't label my items. Okay. So I'm going to do a little line of trees. Some of them kind of come down a little bit into the hill. I'm going to zoom in my photograph here so I can see a little bit better. Okay. And they're going to come up over the top of this misty layer here a little bit. You can't see where I'm at now. Covered everything up. Okay, here we go. There we go, that's better. Sorry, behind the scenes stuff. They're like, what is she doing? They can't see anything that I'm doing here. Okay, so doing some. I'm trying to keep this sort of, you know, semi-realistic. You could go totally, you know, fanciful with it and just do kind of more of a cartoony version, and that would be totally fun and very cool. So whatever. I'm leaving a few gaps for some of these trees are like, there, and then there's a gap, and then there's some trees over here. Whoops, a little off camera there. There's some trees over here. These are a little bit lighter colored, so I'm letting them mix with that light color underneath. All right, grab a little bit more of the dark. Tap in a little bit more of dark here and there. And then I'm going to grab my little teeny tiny brush. That's the technical term for that brush too. It's a rigger. It's got a short, it's like our liner would work. Or okay, get it in camera. And there's just a few little tree branches in here and there that I'm just going to try to indicate. These ones got a little close to the horizon line there. But over here for sure, I'm going to keep them very, very short and are very, very thin. Right there. Okay. And then I'm just going to use that a little bit and fuzz out the bottoms of them, because I don't want them to look like they've attach themselves to nothing. Like I want a little bit of maybe a little shadow or something underneath them. So I'm going to use that brush and a little bit of that color just to kind of run a horizontal line underneath them here and there. Okay. That's about all we're going to do for that. Let's put in a little bit extra highlights in our clouds, and then we'll put in our balloons. I probably should have done this before, not just right before my balloons, because it's gonna, might have to have you dry this. We'll see. No promises, but you never know. All right, I'm gonna use white. I'm gonna add just a teeny, teeny, tiny bit of yellow, cadmium yellow. to it so that it's kind of golden white, but very, very, very light. So it's only barely tinted white yellow. And I'm going to use my angle brush here in this case. Just going to give me a little bit more control, but you could use whatever you've got. And I'm going to go around this cloud and add some little taps, just little taps of really bright highlight. If it gets too bright, use your finger, wipe it in a little bit. I'm just trying to put in, I'm going to put in a few clouds that I didn't put in earlier that are in this color as well, that are kind of coming up diagonally this way. Oops, a little bit off there, sorry. Zoom out. Just a teeny tiny bit.
Well, I was just zooming out so people could watch you paint. Since you can keep going off camera.
Okay. Have I been going off camera? Didn't know I had been.
I'll have to go back and watch and see.
Okay, I don't think I was. I was trying to keep an eye on it.
Okay.
Was I?
Come on.
Well, I thought you were saying somebody was complaining that I was off camera or something.
No. It just, the way you're reacting sounded like that.
Okay.
Because I wasn't watching, that's for sure.
No, I was off camera. It wasn't off camera. It was this picture that was covering it.
Oh, okay.
It was covering a little bit of it.
Blame it on the picture.
Just adding these really bright highlights to the tops and just a few clouds that kind of maybe are sticking up here and catching some light. Just a little bit, fuzz out the bottoms of them a little bit. Keep them kind of horizontal-ish and don't crowd them. You can see there's a lot of space between these. I'm not doing a solid line. I'm tapping and then sort of blending out that bottom edges. So they'll get bright on the top, and then the bottom is also going to get a bright section. The middle part's going to stay dark. And there might be a little bit of light showing through here and there where the clouds have parted. But for the most part, you're going to keep your light kind of on the outside of that cloud. I'm going to use my finger and blend it out a little bit. There's a little bit that kind of comes down here. There's a little bit of it here. I didn't go exactly by my picture on this, so I'm kind of just figuring it out as I go here. These clouds are a little bit lower to the horizon in my picture, but I made them a little bit higher up.
So I had a question again about your color chart.
Mm-hmm.
You have a video on that?
I do not, but I did. I really need to do one, though.
Yeah.
That probably is going to be something I'll do in my Patreon group when I get it started. And that is going to be starting next week. I'm going to have that ready. I worked on it this week. And then I lost all of my saved stuff. So that was fun. Spent 3 hours setting it all up. And then went to put it live and it was gone. So I'm going to try again. And hopefully it'll work this time. But yeah, I'm going to have, it's going to be fun. There's going to be a lot of really cool new stuff for the Patreon folks if you want to join. You know, we'll be doing our two videos a week for those who don't, you know, join me on Facebook or anything like that. But those who are a little bit more active and want to get more involved, we're going to have a new Facebook group for challenges for certain levels and new videos. Ooh. Secret Patreon only extra live shows and little chats, live chats in the group on Facebook for members only to get some little tips like that, little things that, you know, I might not do. do a project, but I'll show you, you know, how to clean your brushes and what brushes or, you know, what kind of canvases I like to use or, you know, just different behind the scenes type of stuff. And it'll be interactive, so you can chat with me while I'm doing it. So I think it'll be fun. I'm looking forward to getting that going, and we'll do, you know, personalized critiques if you want it, critiques on your artwork and that kind of thing. So it's mostly some of the stuff that I've been doing in my Thankful Art group, but it'll be on Patreon now, and so we'll switch a lot of... We'll still do some stuff in Thankful Art, but it'll more of the in-depth stuff will be over in the Patreon group once we get it going. Okay, I'm going to grab some glazing medium in this color, and I'm going to throw my sun in right here, and I'm going to pull it down over the mountain here. There's some little sunbeams that come down.
Somebody asked, what is Patreon?
Patreon is a website where it's created for artists to connect with their fan base. So it's a way for folks who, you know, who have been supporting my videos by donating money to me, and there have been several that have done that over the last couple of years. It's a way for me to know who they are and thank them in a way, because it gives you like perks for different levels of donations. So right now, when somebody donates, well, it used to be. Now with the Super Chat, we're getting to see, it's a new feature where when you donate during the live shows, it'll actually pop up so I can see who donated. But before, when somebody would donate, I wouldn't even get a name, so I wouldn't even know who had donated. It was all anonymous. So Patreon kind of connects you with your as an artist, it connects you with the people who are wanting to support my channel. And then it also, I'm grabbing some blue here, it also allows me to get to know them and thank them and give them some extra bonus videos and different, you know, perks. And we'll have a group that I'll have some giveaways, monthly giveaway, you know, for a certain level. So there's different levels of giving. The first level would be $1 or $2, and we'll have the traceables in that level. And then the second level is going to be like a bonus video once a month. And I'm putting some blue up here just to hint of it. Grab a little bit more of my glazing medium to make it blend. There we go. Felt like it just needed a little bit of blue up here. Just kind of unify it a little bit. Okay, zoom out, get the full picture here. Whoop, I touched something on my camera there. It's manual focus, I think, so hopefully it's still working. Looks like it is. It's something I've been thinking about doing for a couple of years, but I wanted to get to where I was doing my regular schedule and had that all nailed down so that I knew what I could offer and what, you know, what I could have time to offer. So this will just add, I'm already doing weekly art chats in Thankful Art, which they're going to continue, but they're not going to be as in-depth, and I'll be doing the really in-depth one over in Patreon. So, and then we'll be adding one extra video a month live show that's just for them. So, and then the challenges and different things. So I'll probably, once I get that up next week, I'll probably talk more about it next week when I have it live ready to go. I think we're okay on this, honey. I don't think I'm going to need you to, as long as I stay away from that, but I think my balloon's going in right here, so I think we're okay. So isn't that pretty? So you could be done right here. You could just say, I'm done. And if you were a beginner painter, you know, you probably, I would say that this would be, you know, a good level to stop at if you don't want to. But if you want a challenge, I would say let's put in some balloons. The balloons are just going to be a little bit more difficult, not too bad, but they were a little trickier than I kind of expected them to be. Let me see. I think I'm going to use my pencil just because I don't think the chalk's going to show up very well. All right, so my first big one is going to be right here. It's going to take up most of this room right here on my photograph. I'm lowering it just slightly because I want it to be kind of more in the third range. So if I, when I say thirds, there's a, if you split it this way, there's my third lines. So I want to keep it in this line, and then my third line over here is going to be here and here if I split this into thirds. So if I can catch that balloon right into that third, that's kind of ideal placement for just composition wise. So the top is going to be rounded. Make it as wide as I need it to go. And try to kind of get those sides even. I will have a traceable for this. And until next week, it'll be still free. So February 1st will be the first, I think, when the traceables will start going to Patreon. And they'll only be a dollar, and we'll have eight. Well, a dollar for eight of them for the whole month. So every... Okay. I feel like, let me zoom in so you can see the drawing better. Okay. So it's basically a teardrop shape. So you're going to really narrow it down almost to a point, and where you might normally do your little V shape at the end, you're going to just do a little line, and there's actually a little opening, so there's kind of like a squashed circle right there. All right, so I'm wanting to make sure though that that is right in the middle of my thing, so actually it needs to come over just a little bit. Thought it was looking a little bit off. So there. That'll help you kind of get your sides even. And just do, the top is going to have these little bubbles that'll come down, little sections. So if you want to draw those in, this is the only one that I'm getting really technically detailed on. The rest of them, not, because they're so far away, you can't really see these details. But these lines are going to kind of disappear as they come around this corner a little bit. So you'll still see a little bit of them, but they're not going to be as visible there. Okay. In fact, I think I'm going to round this out just right here a little bit more. Make sure I'm getting it even on both sides. Let me look at it this way. I think so. So the top's going to be rounded. And these are all going to kind of come in and curve in toward this point. And I'm trying to kind of keep them about the even distance apart. If I can, they'll actually get spaced a little bit closer together as they come around that. Actually, they're kind of doing like this. As they come around this corner here, they're a little bit closer together. There we go. Like that. All right, and then the little... there's like a little flap that kind of comes in like right here. So just making sure that I get, once I get my outline where I like it, I'm going to darken it up a little bit so I can see it better. And you could sketch this out on paper. I would probably, ideally, that's probably what I would do. Do that a lot when I'm doing paintings. Sketch it on paper, and then once I get the drawing exactly the way I want it, then I come down to, I trace it out and put it on canvas. So, and actually these are coming up now that I'm looking at my picture. These are actually cutting off more like that. So there's our, because they're all kind of coming to a point from up here. So I didn't round these off correctly there.
So what other techniques could you use instead of using your watercolor pencil? Could you use chalk?
You could use chalk. You could use, well, like I said, you could draw it on paper and then transfer it over. That's probably the ideal way of doing it, just, you know, if you're a beginner, because then you can practice and get it just right and then trace it and transfer it onto your canvas. Okay, so that's better. So I'm going to erase over these. They're not going to be there. Sorry. Just getting busy talking. I'm not even paying attention to what I'm doing here. Okay, so there's just a little bit. You can't really see the strings in the picture very well, but I'm going to go ahead and put them in anyways just for my own benefit. And then so down from this opening, straight down, there's like a little box right here. And then there's a diagonal that drops down just slightly right here. And I might have gotten that a little too far down. Let me get it a little closer to my balloon. I'll wipe it off with my rag. There we go. Then they angle like that. Ooh, that adding water to it really make it dark. Made it dark, but I want to make sure that it's straight down from my opening. So right there. Okay, so there's my first balloon. Then I've got a little baby one that's right here that's just slightly off center. So he's right here, really low and very, very small. This will be the smallest one. So just go ahead and draw your teardrop shape. Cut off the bottom a little bit and give him a teeny tiny little square basket right there. All right, then the next one is on the third here, just about, maybe a little bit off the third. So actually this is my third here. So he's just off the third here and right on the third line on this side. So, and he's right in here. He's my medium-sized balloon. Because these are all guys. Oh, this is gonna be fun. We'll give Stickman a balloon. He'll have a balloon in the background. Okay, narrow it down. Small, flat, and little teeny tiny square for the basket. These farther ones, you don't have to go into as much detail. Then this one is a little bit higher and kind of a little closer to this one than this one. So it's just right here, but it's still below the top of this balloon. So right in here. Kind of medium size. Flat bottom. Top of the balloons are almost kind of flat too, flattened a little bit also. So it's kind of like a light bulb shape almost, or flattened. Go, and then a little tiny basket. All right, let me zoom out. You can see our composition there, the placement. Pretty good, I think. And I'm going to use a quarter inch angle to fill in the balloon. And I decided to simplify it from the photograph. The photograph had a bunch of different colors and thingies going on, and I just didn't want to deal with that. So I'm going to use the quinacridone magenta and some of this unbleached titanium. Thin that down. And that'll be kind of our base color, and I'll go ahead and sort of try to fit it in a little bit with the sections just on this one. So I'm not completely mixing these colors, so there's a little bit of streaking going on. I'm I'm just filling it in the direction of those sections. And I'm going to grab a little bit more of my light color. Whoop. While it's wet, and just going to blend in a little bit of this lighter. If you're doing this and you're a beginner, I would just put it in solid. Don't worry about your sections. Just paint it in solid, maybe do a little bit darker color on one side and be done. I don't think you need to do all of this super detailed stuff. It would be really frustrating, I think. So you just decide what level of frustration you want to, not frustration, what level of detail you want to put in. These are pretty detailed. I'm going to grab some glazing medium to help it blend a little bit. As I get towards the center, I'm going to go a little bit darker as I gradually darken the sections. And I'm not really staying in the lines perfectly, and then you don't have to. I'm not going to like perfectly outline all of them. I'm just trying to suggest a little bit of that so I don't have to do it later. Just trying to suggest these sections by kind of choosing a brush that's the width of the sections so that I'm getting these stripes in it a little bit. Hopefully you can see that. Let me zoom in. Oh, too far. There we go. Get a little white water to my brush here. It felt like it was getting dry. There we go. How you doing, hun?
Fantastic. How did that sound?
Good.
Good.
Enthusiastic.
Oh, yeah.
So what you wanted to be doing on your Saturday?
I just remember my short little tether ride in the hot air balloon.
That's true. You did get to go up and away.
Yeah, somebody didn't want to go up, though.
I don't know who you would be talking about.
I don't know. Probably the same person who didn't go up in the Ferris wheel.
Nope. Nope, she was smart. That's dumb. I don't remember being scared of heights when I was a kid, but the older I got, the smarter I got, I think, and I just realized that that's not a good idea to do any of that stuff. No zip lining, no... No, yeah, you guys went on roller coasters, and I used to do roller coasters until my ears started messing up, and then I can't do the roller coasters either, which is kind of a bummer. Roller coasters don't bother me for some reason, but because I'm strapped in, it's like when I'm loose, you know, like on the Ferris wheel and on a balloon or something, that just the idea of that I could fall out is terrifying. It's not fun sounding at all in any way. Okay, I'm adding a little bit. I've mixed black with my, whoops, didn't want to do that. Mixed black with my quinacridone magenta. Whoop. Okay, I need to stay away from this side because I really want this side to be lighter. But I'm trying to blend this out and it's not working. Okay, so don't go over to this side right now because it's still drying. I'm going to use this dark color on this side. I'm putting a little bit in between these two, just outlining them. And then I'm going to use it to fill in this half of the balloon. How are we doing for time? An hour and a half, so that's about right. I figured it'd be about a two-hour project where we'll get through this one. This will be the hardest one. The smaller ones are a lot easier. They're not as detailed. Just making sure that my two sides match as much as I can make them match. Okay, so dark, and I'm putting these in with this curve in mind. I'm trying to keep my curves correct of the balloon. So once it gets to the middle part, then it then this second half kind of goes dark, way darker. It's that black and quinacridone that'll make it dark. I'm just going to pull through that wet paint and sort of try to pull some indications of some highlights. See how it's like lifting a little bit of that paint. And I'll go ahead and, put a little bit of it on this side. This side's drying a little bit, so I'm going to let that dry completely. We'll come back to it. Let's put a little bit of this black, the really, really dark color, in this little circle that we drew right here. And this little flap that's right here kind of comes down. Use that edge of my brush to draw in my lines if I need to. Okay. All right, so that's that balloon for now. We'll leave it. I'm going to grab my number two round, wherever it is. There it is. And I don't even remember using this brush. I don't know why it was in there. Just so weird. I must have used it because it was in the wet.
Yeah, you water. Used it because you held it up real close to the camera, I believe.
No, this is the one I held up. I don't know why I have my number two in there.
They all look the same. It's the brush.
Okay. Okay. I'm going to make a dark gray, and I'm going to fill in the basket with that. And then I'm going to lighten it up and put in the light side of the basket. Or whatever this is called. I wouldn't know because I did not go in it. I think it's a basket.
It is a basket,
yeah. Thank you. Even though it looks like kind of like a rectangle here in this picture. All right, then I'm going to go ahead. I feel like it needed some string, so I'm just going to go ahead and sort of indicate some very, very light something there. And then there's like little dark gray dots at the top where there's probably like equipment. Stuff, maybe people, probably people, you would think, I guess. So just little like that, nothing really defined, but just little dabs and dots. Okay, well, there's kind of the bottom of the basket's showing a little bit too, so I'm gonna do that with the dark gray. Okay, so that one's 75% done. We got to add some highlights and we'll be good on him. And then let's put in this little one here. This one is yellow oxide and unbleached titanium. We'll add in a little bit of white too, just to brighten it up. So we'll put that in. Put it in pretty quickly if you can. Get it in there and then we'll work wet on wet in this one. I'm trying to cover over my lines so none of that shows through, because if you leave any of these lines from the watercolor pencil and then you go to varnish it, they'll smear. So you want to be sure you cover over these lines of your watercolor pencil, or they could cause you grief later. Okay, grab a little bit of the quinacridone, maybe a little bit of burnt sienna. Need to spray my canvas there, pedal it. And we'll just darken up this one side. I'm going to just do these little stripey things here. Try to indicate some little stripes of dark color. We'll need a little bit more color on there, a little bit more flow. There we go. Dark, dark, dark. Then as I get to the middle, I'm just going to barely touch it so that it kind of does this little dry brush thing. Okay? Clean it out. Grab some pure white. And it's going to mix a little bit because I didn't take my time to clean out my brush completely. And I'm going to pull through the wet paint on this side and just put in some little highlight stripes on that side. And that's about all I'm going to do with those. I'm going to grab a little bit of black and mix that with my burnt sienna color. I don't want it to be black, black. It's got to be kind of the right value. Dark there, a little bit of dark underneath the balloon, and that's it. That's it, just a little teeny tiny indication. There, let's do this one. Let's go ahead and put this on while I have it. I'll just use it on all three of these. That dark color, a little dark underneath the balloon where the hole in there, the opening. Clean that out. This one is blue, but it's got that blue-green colors like our trees. That'll help unify it too. So we're going to grab the burnt sienna and mix it with my phthalo blue. I'm going to put this one in with this dark blue. This one I'm getting a little fancier. I'm going to go ahead and put in some stripes just for fun. So once I get this color on, and it's actually kind of a gray in the picture, but I'm going to add a little bit of white. Maybe grab a little bit of that black just to go ahead and gray it out. And this bottom section is pretty dark, so I'm not going to go over it with too light of a color, but then I'm going to grab a little bit more white and do this section, just little stripies like that. And then the top one is the brightest. It's probably white, but it's not going to show up white for us because we're not. Actually, this is bigger now that I'm looking at my picture. This is more, reaches up to the middle section there. Then the whiter. My white's not staying white. Here we go. And it is, these are curving a little bit. As you get toward the top, it kind of goes more straight. So, and I'm leaving little dark through so that I don't have to draw in any lines. I'm just leaving a little bit of that dark color showing through. I'm going to grab a little bit of the gray. I feel like this needs to be a little more gray. There. There we go. And then clean off my brush. And I can let it dry, or I can come back in right now while it's still wet, drying, while it's wet. Grab some really bright white, and we'll just add a little bit of bright white just to this side to brighten it up. If I got this side too dark, I can go back in with my darker and kind of go over a little bit of it to tone it down, make sure that this side is in shadow. Okay. My basket got a little off center there. I'm going to put it a little bit farther to the middle. There we go. And then this one is going to be a kind of a salmon-y color. So it's the quinacridone with the yellow oxide. It'll make kind of a orange. Let me grab a little bit of the yellow. There we go. So we'll fill that in. It's kind of in between these two colors. So it's a good. There. Filling that in. Once we get this done, we'll put a little bit more detail in our big balloon and we'll be done. I'm going to go ahead and, while this is wet, go ahead and put in some of the watercolor there. What are you laughing at? Go grabbing some black. I'm going to add that to that color to darken up this bottom section here. Mark's over here giggling. I feel like I miss out on all the fun when I'm painting here sometimes.
I don't know if I should mention it in the... Oh, you want me to share it? Okay.
Well, I don't know. What did they share?
No,
Is it off color?
It wasn't them sharing, it was me sharing.
Oh, what were you saying?
Oh, you know, just people are talking about, you know, sympathizing with you about you not liking roller coasters or going up on hot air balloons and so on and so forth. And then I just thought, well, you know, maybe we should paint one of the balloons on fire falling out of the sky. And so, yeah, that got some feedback.
Mark Anderson, he's a menace, I swear. Okay, dark color on that side.
Now you're seeing it, aren't you?
I knew that already. I did.
No, you can see.
Oh,
it
I
in
can
your painting.
See that. No, I no? can't. Okay. No, not gonna go there. Okay, I'm gonna do this top section a little bit brighter, with a little bit more quinacridone.
Okay, serious question. What brush are you using there again?
This is a number two round.
And you can't remember if you used it or not.
Escada Perla. I don't think I did.
But
really don't.
It was in the water.
It was in the water, yeah. I don't remember how I used it before, so I don't know how it ended up in the water. It just wanted to get in there and swim with the rest of the friends.
Okay, so what was again number two? What?
Get white here. Number two round.
Round, okay.
It's Escada Perla is the brand. I really like these. They're kind of hard to find. I get them at Dick Blick online. And don't try to type that in, or YouTube will put you on timeout. It's a bad word. Okay, so I'm going to use this lighter color, and I'm going to do a section with this lighter color. Once I get to the darker section, it's blending a little bit with the color. You could do aliens, you could do UFOs in the background. It'd be cool if you wanted to do a sci-fi twist on it. Do that Arrival spacecraft that we watched that movie.
Isn't there some kind of a trend there where they take like classical paintings and they paint in stuff like that?
Yeah, they do. It's the, I want to make it purple here. They take paint by number and they add weird stuff to them. So there's the old, you know, like landscape, paint by number landscape, and then they'll have Chewbacca coming out of the water, or, you know, just something weird, you know. Something you wouldn't, more modern, you know, day. Okay, and then I'm going to do kind of a mixture of the purple and the salmon to do this section right here. I'm not loving these colors as much as my original. Grab some white. Do a little bit of white highlights on this side. I'm trying to keep my sections even, so they match up a little bit. There we go. And then a little bit more up here. Do a little tiny bit at the top. Okay, that's good enough for that. Now let's put a little, I didn't get a lot of highlight on this top one over here. Let's grab a little bit of white for that. Maybe a little bit of blue. Put a little tiny bit up here. Just on that side. Okay. All right. think I'm going to stick with this brush because it's got a good, oh, my goodness, look what I did. I got water on that. So
got a little overexcited about the water there, huh?
I did. It just jumped out and got, you okay?
Oh, yeah, I just bumped my knee again. Somebody asked if you would recommend writing on the finished balloon with a watercolor pencil. People are talking about like putting hearts or different things on the balloons.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, you could. Well, I mean, with the watercolor pencil, I probably wouldn't do it with the watercolor pencil just because it's water soluble. So if you ever got any water on your painting, it would wipe right off. But I would maybe do it with a permanent marker of some sort, like a, not a Sharpie, but like a, sorry. Okay, get that fixed. Okay, don't do that again. Be careful with the brush. Pit pen or the Faber-Castell pit. It's a India ink. Something that says permanent in the title or the description of it. Or an acrylic paint pen would work. Just not... Yeah, I probably wouldn't do watercolor just because I would be afraid that it would, if it ever got water on it, it would remove, smear. Okay, so I'm going to do these little stripes across here. These ones kind of go, I'm just dabbing, kind of go across like that. This is purple, the same kind of purple that I did with a little quinacridone and mostly blue in this case. And then this one is a little bit more straight, but it still curves down right here. Try to find your sections there. And just make sure that you start and stop them at the same place on your balloon. So make sure you come down low enough. And the middle is your high point.
What level of painting expertise would you say this painting is?
This part down here, the landscape part, I would say, you know, maybe second, you know, maybe a level two, you know, maybe not first time painting, but definitely doable for a beginner, you know. The balloon part, though, I would say is more... advanced, you know, but you saw how I did these. You could totally do your big balloon with this technique and just do, you know, very, very simple stripes and not do it quite as detailed as I've been doing with it, and it would work out great. So there are ways of simplifying it to make it a little bit more beginner friendly. I hope that made sense. So the balloons themselves, this one mainly, it's just, you know, depends on your brush control. If you have decent brush control, then I think that, you know, it might be a step up from the background. Not, you know, not the hardest painting you've ever done, but, you know, it's not like on the scale of the Monet one that we did, you know, that was really complicated with a lot of dots and things. Adding a little bit of white, but I think I want yellow. I'm going to mix this unbleached titanium. Maybe add just a teeny tiny bit of the quinacridone to it. Use that as my highlight color. Since my balloon is dry for the most part, and I think that the blue is dry, I'm just going to kind of dry brush over my sections and try to kind of pop them out a little bit. And they don't have to be perfect. Just leaving a little bit of space in between my little stripes so that it looks like there's a shadow. As long as I don't go right up next to this one, it'll look like there's a, you know, there's a shadow there. I think the hardest part of this is just getting your lines right, you know, getting these lines all matching up and all pointing in the right direction. So that's the main difficulty in this painting, I would think. Going a little bit darker as I get toward the middle. So I'm kind of switching out and adding a little bit more quinacridone, a little bit less of the... Okay, whoop, camera there a little bit, sorry. Do... You can see it's kind of taking shape now. I'm going to still stay pretty dark, just a little bit light here, and just put a little bit of the highlight in these sections here, in the dark side, on the dark side, but not nearly as bright as I was over there. Just want to add a little indication of some light peeking through. Going to grab the quinacridone. I'm going to go over some of this that got a little too dark on this side. You can firm up some of your lines with the quinacridone now if you want to go through and darken up between some of these. You can make them a little bit more defined. I think that's pretty good. I don't know. I kind of don't like this middle one here. Like it's a little thick right there. Okay. It doesn't seem like the color's quite right. The light is hitting it, so you can't really see the values very well, I think. We have to adjust our lighting setup. So one of the reasons that we're hoping that the Patreon thing takes off is just so we can update some of our equipment, get a new camera, get a switcher so that we can have have a second camera and, you know, different camera angles, and then get new lighting equipment, and, you know, maybe kind of like to mount all the lights. I've got a little bright highlight. I'm going to highlight this right here and a little bit right here. get all the lights mounted on the ceiling instead of on my desk where they're in the way. So stuff like that, just like little, I think it'll help us kind of make the studio a little bit more video friendly. It's more of, started out more of an art studio. We've kind of slowly been transitioning it into more of a recording studio, you know, as time's gone by. I'm going to add a little bit of the white with the blue purple color to the highlights of this dealie. Just on that side, that'll help kind of push those back, make them look rounded, make them look highlighted. And they're not really very visible right there, so. I don't know. I think we're pretty close. I want to add a little bit more bright highlight just to this one side of my balloon. Maybe grab a little bit of the yellow. Mix a really bright and get some glazing medium. I want to glaze it. So I feel like it's Okay. I'll wipe off most of the extra, but I'm going to use that to brighten up just this one side of it. Add some glazing medium to my quinacridone. There we go. Now that I've got that light color on there, I can go back over with the quinacridone. It'll make it more pink. Okay. I think we're about done. What do you think, hon? Let me zoom out. See how it looks. I could still fiddle with that, maybe add a little bit more, but I'm not going to. We're almost at 2 hours, so. I like how the landscape came down here, though. It definitely looks misty.
Oh, yeah. Everybody loved every bit of it. Good. For sure. Except there's one thing missing.
Oh, yeah. Stickman needs his.
And there was no blow drying, so people are kind of disappointed, but. They couldn't hear the blow dryer in the background.
Next time. Yeah, I feel like it needs a little bit brighter, but it's not going on there because it's wet. So I'll let that set. All right, here's Stickman. He's our mascot. he gets trotted out once a show. Mark drew the original. And we add something to him depending on whatever our theme is for the week. Whatever we're painting. And if you are a beginner, welcome. So glad you're joining us. And please, after the show, you can check out my channel by clicking on my name and going. I'll put a big old hot air balloon right. Let's see, where should we put it? Right up here. You click on my name or my picture, it'll take you to my channel. And there's all kinds of different playlists. There's playlists for beginners, there's more advanced paintings, there's different paintings by theme, by season, all kinds of different paintings. We've got over 100 and something now, almost 150, I think, and 120 something at least paintings, all different kinds. And we do these shows twice a week, Tuesdays and Saturdays. Tuesday nights are at 6 p.m. Central, and Saturdays are at 2. So here's our little hot air balloon guy.
In 2017.
2017, right, yeah. So, yeah, if we're watching 20 years from now, there's no telling.
That's right.
What time we're doing our shows, but yes. And the current schedule is usually on the header of my channel page, homepage up, you know, at the top. So it usually tells what my schedule is. All right, there we have it. Stickman got his hot air balloon thing, and we are done. Hope you've enjoyed this painting. I've really appreciated you guys that stopped by and watched with us live. It's really fun to have you with us, and those who watch later on, totally understand that too. You're part of the crowd. You're just as important. But we thank you guys, and we will see you Tuesday night. Thanks. Bye.